Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. We have apologies this morning from Jackie Bailey and Anna Sarwar, but James Kelly is attending as a substitute. The first item on agenda today is to decide whether to take agenda item 6 and propose the amendments to the written agreement in private. Members agreed. If any member disagrees, please type N in the chat bar. And we are agreed. In which case, the second item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the budget, Scotland Act 2020, Amendment Regulations 2021, draft from Kate Forbes, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, who's been supported by Scott Mackay, who's the Head of Finance and Coordination, and Neil Caldwell, who's the Corporate Treasurer of the Scottish Government. I welcome Kate Forbes, the Cabinet Secretary meeting, and invite her to make any opening remarks.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. I'm delighted to join the Finance Committee for the third budget event in as many days. Time well spent. The Spring Budget Revision provides the final opportunity to formally amend the Scottish Budget for this year, rather than our discussions about next year. This year's Spring Budget Revision deals with five different types of amendments to the budget. And whilst my opening remarks are perhaps longer than I would have liked, I would like to go into the detail of it. So the first amendment is allocation of the remaining COVID-19 consequentials, along with some other funding changes. Secondly, reprioritisation of existing budgets, mainly arising from emerging underspends, which are redistributed to meet pressures arising elsewhere. Thirdly, a number of technical adjustments that have no impact on spending power. That is followed by some Whitehall transfers, and finally, some budget neutral transfers of resources between portfolio budgets. The supporting document to the Spring Budget Revision and the brief guide prepared by my officials provides background on the net changes, and that includes a reconciliation of the cumulative effect of the three budget revisions to date this year and the breakdown of COVID-19 consequentials and other sources of funding across the year. The first set of changes increase the budget by £3,263.5 million and comprises the majority of the COVID-19 funding, which has been allocated over a number of lines, as detailed in the brief guide. The second set of changes comprise budget underspends and savings, which are being redeployed to support the COVID-19 response. Those adjustments amount to £745.4 million. The third set of changes comprise a number of large technical adjustments to the budget. The technical adjustments are mainly non-cash and therefore budget neutral and have a net negative impact of £679.1 million on the overall aggregate position. It's necessary to reflect these adjustments to ensure the budget is consistent with the accounting requirements and with the final outturn that will be reported in our annual accounts. With regard to Whitehall transfers and allocations from Treasury, there's a net positive impact on the budget from a number of transfers of £18.2 million. And the final part of the budget revision concerns the transfer of funds within and between portfolios to better align the budgets with profiled spend. So in terms of the cumulative position, taken together, the three budget revisions have provided over £9.8 billion of COVID-19 and other funding changes to this year's Scottish budget. That's been funded by £8.6 billion of COVID-19 consequentials, £1.1 billion of reprioritisation of existing expenditure, with £89 million in other sources of funding. Following this budget revision, total COVID-19 funding for health, which includes wider health initiatives, has reached £3.1 billion, with total support for business in this financial year in excess of £3.2 billion. And I think that contrast actually is quite stark in terms of the spend on health and the spend on business. As we approach the financial year end, we will continue in line with our normal practice to monitor forecast outturn against budget and utilise any emerging underspends to ensure we make optimum use of the resources available this year. That's what we've been doing throughout this year, and I'm sure I will touch on that in some of my answers, particularly on business support, as well as managing the necessary carry forward to meet additional spending commitments reflected in the budget agreement reached for next year. In line with the recommendations of the Budget Process Review Group's recommendations, my officials have included in the brief guide sent to the committee an indication of the forecast outturn position, and provisional outturn figures will be announced in early June. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We'll just go straight to questions, and can I ask Murdo Fraser, please, to commence the questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning again, Cabinet Secretary. Can I ask a couple of questions around the reprioritisations in the budget that you just referred to there? So, as far as we can see, the total sum reprioritised is 745 million, which is a really chunky part of the budget for the current year. And I think we all appreciate that because of COVID pressures, there was a need to do some of that. But can you break that figure down for us a bit in terms of how much of that is capital and how much of that is revenue?
Yes, I can. So the majority of that £745 million of reprioritisation amounts to capital and FT underspend, which has been redeployed to support the economic recovery. And in all of these cases, funds have been redeployed to service providers to best support the COVID-19 response. So in committee previously, whether it's talking about next year's budget or this year's budget, colleagues have asked about funding that has been allocated to, for example, the Scottish National Investment Bank, where it has gone. And so if I were to break that down, £93 million of financial transactions assigned to the Scottish National Investment Bank has been redeployed. That's been redeployed in this budget revision to include, for example, £25 million for sport, £30 million for the third sector, and the remainder is being utilised for smaller transfers, with £22 million being left for deployment next year. £94 million has been redeployed to support COVID-19 pressures through a reduction in Network Rail enhancement and operational and maintenance requirement capital budgets. £75 million of the National Rail funding has been requested to be carried forward to future years in line with flexibilities. I'll keep going if that's okay. A total of £90 million of Social Security programme and administrative costs, which is mainly resource, has been redeployed to support the funding position. That's had no impact on the delivery of benefit expenditure. And £78 million of demand-led underspend in energy grants has been redeployed. The bulk of that is capital. About £4 million of that has been resource. And again, it's been redeployed to support programmes elsewhere in the budget. The last one is on business support. And this relates to a timing difference. So in previous budget revisions, I talked about the fact that we were using any emerging underspend in demand-led programmes and redeploying that. So, for example, in the initial local government grants that were allocated, we redeployed forecast underspend to fund the pivotal Enterprise Resilience Fund and also to fund the October business support packages. So we had increased the budget for business spend in previous budget revisions with the understanding that the final figure of underspend on those initial programmes would materialise and crystallise later on. And so this budget revision is basically an accounting adjustment for what we have previously redeployed but hadn't factored into previous revisions. So we'd increased the previous budget revisions, and in this budget we account for the underspend that previously funded that, if that makes sense, but I'm happy to clarify that further.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. Can I ask then, as a follow-up, would you expect, where we've seen large reductions in the capital spend, that these will be put back into the budget for the coming year, or has that in fact already been done, or are we still waiting to see what the impact of COVID will be, for example, on major infrastructure projects?
I think, so firstly, you will see, and I'm happy to go into details about the reserve, but you will see that there is a forecast carry forward into next year. So it's true to say that some of those budgets do materialise next year. That's obviously the case when it comes to health on the resource side, but on the capital side, that's clear when it comes to the Scottish National Investment Bank and also some of the other infrastructure projects. So yes, there is an assumption that where demand has been less this year, we have had to allocate that next year. Another good example of that is when it comes to support for reskilling and retraining. So we had factored into this year's budget the commitment on the Young Persons Guarantee, but due to an extension of the furlough scheme, that increase in unemployment wasn't seen when we expected it last autumn. We now anticipate it crystallising at the end of the furlough scheme in over the summer months. So we have increased the budgets next year, and where they haven't been used this year, they have been redeployed to meet other needs.
Okay, thank you for that. But just to clarify that a little bit further, I mean, perhaps just take an example. You mentioned the 93.5 million reduction in the rail spend, which is to do with capital improvements. Is it intended that that will be reinstated in the budget for the coming year?
Yes. So I think I said £75 million of that national rail funding is carried forward in line with Treasury flexibility. So £75 million of that will be carried forward into next year.
Okay. All right. Thank you, convener.
Murdo, I'm very grateful for your questions. Dean, I think you may have a question at this stage.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Yeah, to follow up some of the issues discussed with Murdo Fraser, Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned that the total budget of the Scottish National Investment Bank has been redeployed. Can I, and sorry, I didn't catch all of what you said, can you confirm how much of the bank's budget for this current financial year has been redeployed?
Yeah, so if I talk about this year that we're in currently and then talk about next year, this year, Scottish National Investment Bank have returned or redeployed a financial transactions budget of £85 million. And Building Scotland, the Building Scotland Fund is redeploying £8.5 million as per the latest forecasting information from the bank. And reduced forecast outturn is due to revised assumptions on the timing of investment drawdowns and their final confirmation of their planned investment activity. That has not been lost. Obviously, there's limits to what we can carry forward. So we redeploy funding in year, and the majority of that has been redeployed in this budget revision to other areas. And I can go into detail again. That would include £25 million for sport. You will remember the sport package that we did. Financial transactions are what we use for loan funding, so for football, for rugby, to keep them afloat. £30 million for the third sector and charities. Again, there was loan funding alongside grant funding. And the remainder is being utilised for smaller transactions, smaller transfers. There is finally £22 million left for deployment next year. And if I move into next year's budget, which we've scrutinised as recently as Monday, you will see the overall £200 million plus factored in for the Scottish National Investment Bank, which is based on a best available estimates for what investment activity they have for next year.
Thanks very much. That's a helpful level of detail there. And overall, does the spring budget revisions recognise any new contingent liabilities compared to the original budget?
On that one, I am going to ask if any officials want to come in on contingent liabilities. And if not, we can follow up in writing.
Not seeing an R or some any of your officials wanting to jump in and provide the information at this stage, Kate.
I'm not aware of any new contingent liabilities. So if there's anything that I have missed, I will follow up in writing.
Thanks very much. And one final question, if I may, convener. It's about the accounting adjustment, Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned. This one in relation to the increase in the student loan charge. I think it increased by about £217 million. Which seems to arise from an impairment in the value of the student loan book, which presumably arises from the operation of IAS 36, which I'm sure you're familiar with. Just wanted either yourself or the officials to provide a bit of background on the reasons for the impairment to the student loan book and this corresponding charge.
And I can ask officials if they want to come in. I think this relates to a new approach to the way that we account for student loans. It doesn't have. It is a technical change, which I think you mentioned, and it's to do with the new way and new means of accounting for student loans. I'm pretty sure it has featured in previous budget revisions that we've taken forward, and it is a technical adjustment to recognise the accounting requirement for how we account for student loans, that it doesn't have a material financial impact on our budget.
Okay, so I appreciate it's not a cash item, so it doesn't decline the level of cash available in the budget, but the notes I saw talked about some impairments of the recoverability of the student loan book because of obvious things that have happened over the past year. So I wonder if there is signs that the level of recoverability in the student loan book may be subject to some question?
Well, again, I will put that one down to one that I will come back to you on in terms of any changes in this year's budget or this year's budget revision versus previous years. I'm not aware of there being a material or a significant change this year versus previous years. This technical adjustment is a relatively new one. I think the accounting changes only came into effect in recent years. So I'm happy to give some thought to what the changes are this year versus previous years, but it's not something that I'm aware of being more significant this year than in previous year. But you're right in saying quite important to identify that as a non-cash item.
Okay. Thank you very much. Convener, back to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean. James Kelly, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to ask about the reserve position from the Spice paper, that it's forecast at $495 million, and just maybe give a bit of commentary as to how that's been built up and what the thinking is in terms of using that reserve going forward.
Yeah, thanks. So, as you know, but I'll say it again, as we come to the final stages of every budget, there is a significant challenge, particularly this year, in balancing the potential pressures and underspends which are forecast to emerge within a fixed budget and the requirement to have that fixed budget. This year, it's particularly challenging with the broad range of demand-led initiatives. So usually it's challenging, but this year we've got business support schemes, we've got vaccination programmes, we've got test and protect. So I am very keen to ensure that all funds are used. Some of the pressures have moved from this year to next year. So particularly on the NHS, our best available evidence is that those pressures haven't reduced, but they're more likely to fall next year rather than this year. So there is a range of pressures and there is a range of savings which did not materialise this year. In terms of the carry forward, £231 million of resource and £200 million of FTs are anticipated in next year's budget. And so we have assumed that those will be carried forward. The last point I would make, and then I'll ask if officials want to come in and add anything, is that this year in particular, we worked with Treasury because of the late consequentials that materialised. So obviously we had late consequentials as recently as the end of February, but even the consequentials that materialised in December, they're challenging to plan for, because up until that point, we had been planning on the basis that there would be no further funding, and therefore any of those late consequentials have to be carried forward within the reserve limits. And although the reserve limits have increased because of the Scotland specific shock provisions, it does mean that we are trying to carry forward as much as possible to meet the demand wherever it lands, and that might be a few days into the next financial year rather than a few days before the end of this financial year. But Scott Mackay might have more to say on reserve, unless you want to come back in with another question.
Okay, Scott, on you go.
So just in terms of the balance that's been signalled there in the brief guide, the majority of that, as the Cabinet Secretary has just indicated, is already assumed in budgets. So we're actually slightly short on the basis of the latest forecast on the resource carry forward figure. We still need some movement to come between now and the end of the year to meet the 231 that's already factored into to budget settlements for 21-22.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay. James, anything else?
No, thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. Nothing further from me, Convener.
Thank you, James. Most grateful. Nobody else has indicated they want to ask a question at this stage, so we now move to agenda item 3, which is consideration of motion on the order. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move S5M2425-4, that the Finance and Constitution Committee recommends that the Budget Scotland Act 2020 Amendment Regulations 2021 draft be approved.
I move that the Finance and Constitution Committee recommends that the Budget Scotland Act 2020 Amendment Regulations 2021 be approved.
I'm assuming that members have no further comments to make at this stage. I therefore now put the question. The question is that motion S5M24254 be agreed. Are we all agreed? If a member disagrees, then please type an N in the chat bar. I see no N appearing, and therefore we are agreed. I'll suspend now for 5 minutes to allow for a changeover of witnesses, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and our officials for providing us with the evidence this morning. We suspend for 5 minutes until 10:26. Thank you. We now move to our evidence session on the Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Lower Rate Order 2021 SSI 21/89, and we're joined for this item by Ivan McKee, who is the Minister for Trade, Innovation and Public Finance, Ewan Cameron Nielsen, who is the head of Fully Devolved Taxes Unit, Directorate of Tax and Fiscal Sustainability, and Ninian Christie, who is a solicitor with the Scottish Government. I warmly welcome the Minister to the meeting this morning, and I would invite Ivan McKee to make any opening remarks if he wishes to do so.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. The Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Lower Rate Order 2021 specifies the standard rate and lower rates for Scottish Landfill Tax, consistent with the rates set out in the Scottish Budget 2021-22, published on 6 February 2020. The order sets out that the standard rate will increase from £94.15 per tonne to £96.70 per tonne. The lower rate for less polluting inert materials will increase from £3 per tonne to £3.10 per tonne. These proposed rates would come into effect from 1st of April 2021. Committee members will wish to note that they match landfill tax rates in the rest of the UK for the financial year 2021-22, as confirmed in the UK budget last week and in the draft Welsh budget in December. The Scottish Government has continued to act to avoid any potential for waste tourism to emerge as a result of material differences between the tax rates north and south of the border. The increased tax rates provide appropriate financial incentives to support delivery of our ambitious waste and circular economy targets, including our zero waste goal that no more than 5% of total waste should go to landfill by 2025. I am happy to take questions.
Thank you, Minister. And we'll go straight to questions. And the first question will come from Alexander Burnett. Alexander.
Thank you very much, Convener. Minister, it's a quick question really around the consequences of a rise. I'm afraid I've asked the question many times. I've still yet to receive any satisfactory answer. I don't think anyone disagrees with the principles or the direction that landfill tax is moving in, but it kind of escaped the Minister's eye that the levels of fly tipping and general litter have reached epic levels across Scotland. Councils are clearly not resourced sufficiently to deal with it and have other priorities. So for the final time, Ms. Parliament, can I ask the Minister what's he going to do at a national level to address the consequences of this increase?
Well, clearly the focus, the tax is for landfill, and as the member recognises, we've got a policy commitment to reduce and eliminate landfill waste. Clearly, any unauthorised disposals are they're unnecessary, they're dangerous, and completely unacceptable. And we continue to work with CEPA and local authorities to ensure we have effective prevention and enforcement measures in place. Revenue Scotland, of course, is responsible for the collection and administer of taxes, devolved taxes, including the landfill tax and the compliance strategy and activity around about that. But as I say, there's work ongoing with local authorities, with CEPA and with the police where appropriate to tackle the issue of unauthorised disposals.
So, can I just ask the Minister, when he talks about the measures of in place and the compliance, is he happy when he sees the level of fly tipping that those measures are actually working?
Well, I mean, it's something I've experienced in my own constituency and had to engage with the appropriate authorities to have that problem resolved. And in that particular case, we were largely successful and the problem was resolved. But I understand that is an issue that local authorities and others. Enforcement agencies, CEPA, the police and others deal with on an ongoing basis. As I said, it's completely unacceptable practice, completely unnecessary, and something that those agencies will continue to address.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Alexander. John Mason, please.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I mean, really on a similar theme, but hopefully in a slightly more realistic manner. I mean, I confess I struggle with this because on the one hand, of course, we don't want stuff going to landfill. Therefore, I totally support the rates and the increase in the rates. And at the same time, we struggle with this that, I mean, some people would probably dump anyway, whatever the landfill rates were. But some people, you know, are doing jobs at night or whatever, and then just dumping the stuff around the constituencies. I just wonder somehow, can we get a more joined up approach with the councils? Because the councils are struggling as well, because they're trying to keep their staff separate, and they've cut down, or at least Glasgow has cut down on the amount of pickups. You know, I honestly don't have an answer to this. I'm just asking the minister, I suppose, you know, can you take all these points on board and try and weigh them up?
I think that's done, and I think the direction we are heading in with working to have alternatives to landfill through reuse, recycling, and other options for disposal of waste that are less environmentally damaging is having an impact. I understand there are challenges, as I said, with illegal activity. That is something that's it's always existed. It's something we continue to take enforcement measures against. But I think in terms of the taxation aspects of this that we're here to talk about this morning, that approach that we have, I think, is the correct one.
Yeah, I mean, I accept that we are here to focus on the tax. So I don't want to go too far off. But I just think we've got a lot of individuals who want to recycle and want to reuse. But, I mean, where I live, people don't have cars. The glass doesn't get picked up. So what can they do but send it to landfill? So I would just appeal, you know, I'm not blaming anyone. I just think we have to be joined up between CEPA, the government, and councils. But thanks for your answer anyway.
Yeah, thank you.
Patrick, please. Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Minister.
Morning.
The Minister's opening remarks talked about the ambition that the Scottish Government has in this area. But he also said, and the policy note also mentions, that the rates are consistent with those in place in the rest of the UK. So can I just ask about the decision-making process here? Does the UK decide what the rates are going to be and the Scottish Government has a standing policy of just following in lockstep? Or is there a joint decision-making process where ministers from the various governments come together, take advice and reach a shared decision? I can see the case for having consistency, but where does the decision making lie?
Well, I think as with all devolved taxation, we've got the authority to be able to set those as we see fit. Now, I can't speak for anyone else, but I personally haven't been involved in any discussions with UK ministers on this. I think there is decisions that we would make and the Welsh would make, and frankly the UK government would make as well, because this can be a two-way street to set rates that that are appropriate based on the circumstances. We do have the ability to obviously deviate as we see fit from the rates that apply across the rest of the UK, but again it's where it makes sense to do so. So what we've got this year is an inflation increase. The rest of the UK has got the same rates, which would also be an inflation increase. If we thought there was a reason to do it differently for policy reasons, then we could do so. But the decision we've made is that there isn't any reason we can see to do it differently at this point in time, and that's the reason for the inflation increase.
Okay, so you're not aware of any dialogue between the governments to decide what the best rate to set is. The UK government sets it, and then the Scottish government copies it.
Well, it's an inflation increase, right? So it's based on the inflation rate, based on RPI. So RPI obviously is a number that's common across the whole of the UK. We could make a decision to do it differently and deviate from the inflation rate increase, and we'd be perfectly capable of doing that if we decided that was the right thing to do. The decision we've made this year is that an inflation rate increase makes sense. So I think it's not a question of following the UK government, it's a question of following the inflation rate effectively.
Well, yeah, matter of perspective there, I think, but thank you very much.
Okay, Patrick, thank you very much. No one else has indicated they want to ask a question. We now therefore move to agenda item 5, which is consideration of the motion on the order. I invite the Minister to move S5M24234, that the Finance and Constitution Committee recommends that the Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Low Rate Order 2021 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question, therefore, is that motion S5M24234 be agreed. Are we all agreed? If any member disagrees, please type N in the chat bar. No one has typed N in the chat bar, therefore we all agreed. Thank you. We'll publish our report on the two instruments considered today, later this week, as this is the last public item on agenda, and I think the last planned meeting in this parliamentary session. Only remains for me to sincerely thank all of our committee members for the consensual and really diligent way you've gone about your business. To say a huge thanks to the clerks for the fantastic support, advice and high level of professionalism. That being said, I now close the public part of the meeting.
Just before you close, Bruce, can I just say a couple of things? First of all, can I just echo your thanks to all the clerking team? Some members might not be aware, but our clerking team were called in to staff the coronavirus committee when it was set up last year. So for a large part of last year, they were double jobbing, having to serve as our committee, but also serve the coronavirus committee, which I convened at that point. So perhaps I have a slightly different perspective. I know that they had to do two jobs at once. So I think there's a particular additional thanks due to them. But also, I think we have to put on record as committee members our thanks to you, Bruce, for convening the committee. I think almost from the very start of the Parliament, I think, if I remember rightly, Michael Russell was the convener for a very short period before he was elevated to Cabinet, and then you came in. And it's been a pleasure working with you, and I think you have demonstrated your capabilities as an able chair of the committee with a remarkable track record in achieving consensus around reports. Given the diversity of views on the committee, that is no mean feat. So I think we would like to thank you and pay tribute to you for your service in this committee and indeed to the Parliament over the period that you've been an MSP, and wish you a very happy retirement.
Thank you, Bardo. That's very kind of you. Very kind of you indeed. I think only probably remains for me to say, yeah, it's been a blast. And over and out, and I'll see you in MS Teams in 5 minutes' time. Thank you very much.